So thank you very much for this very kind introduction. So it's great to be here and to be able to explain some of the more mathematical aspects underlying this whole field of tensor networks and quantum many body systems. So I'm sure that Thomas Bartel has given you an extremely good and thorough introduction to the field. So especially probably talked especially about the motivation, why are we using these tensor networks, what are they good for? Probably talked about area laws, also about algorithms of how to actually use these methods for simulating quantum many body systems. So by the way, just to recapitulate what he for sure said, the central problem in physics and especially in theoretical physics is to solve the many body Schrödinger equation. This is basically everything, all the breakthroughs in physics since the 1930s have been exactly about that topic. And you have to really kind of look at these tensor networks in that context. It's really a way of solving the quantum many body problem in a completely new way, maybe in a way by which you make use of ideas of quantum information, of quantum entanglement. But it turns out that it's not just a way of solving these equations, it's also a new way of understanding the physics behind it. And this is mainly the lecture that I will give you today is basically about the mathematics needed to kind of take this or get this new understanding, especially of things like topological phases of matter. Turns out that these tensor networks are perfectly suited to tackle these questions. How do you classify? What are the possible different phases of matter? How do you understand phase transitions? All these things turn out to be very much intertwined with describing wave functions of these quantum many body physics in terms of tensors. So that's basically one fundamental underlying idea of these tensor networks is that you kind of look at global properties. You have a Hilbert space of many, many particles, as Thomas explained to you. Nevertheless, you kind of are able to reduce that problem to a local problem. Okay, so it's always you start from something global, maybe see infinite dimensionally, infinitely large, but you relate, you're at the end able to discuss or describe these objects by just talking about simple local objects. And that is, of course, somehow the power of these tensor network methods, but also allows to kind of now study these many body, these non-local properties by just looking at the local tensors. And this is what we will be concerned with today. So here is an overview of the talk. So sorry for my handwriting. I thought that this. I like very much in mathematical conferences and all the conferences I've been in mathematics. Actually, it's like last week there was a whole conference on fusion categories. Somehow people write their slides, and I like this very much because you can also write on them. But you have to apologize. I have to apologize. My handwriting is very bad. But nevertheless, forgive me. But somehow it should be readable. What is the overview of my talk? So my talk consists of two parts. There's a part today, there's a part on Friday, but of course both kind of naturally follow on each other. So in the first chapter, I will talk about matrix product states. Okay? So again, you have had a very kind of thorough introduction about this, but I will recapitulate basically the definitions and especially the mathematical concepts, so the mathematical, the important mathematical theorems that underlie somehow working with these matrix product states. And this is especially like this second section here, this is the second section is actually of fundamental importance, and that's why we call this the fundamental theorem of matrix product states. Almost every theoretical or mathematical result that concerns tensor networks is in one or the other way connected to this fundamental theorem of matrix product states. Maybe it's a bit of a misnomer, but somehow it's because it's so fundamental that we call it the fundamental theorem. So one application, for example, of this is the characterization of symmetric tensor networks. Okay, so these are tensors with some kind of symmetries, and these turn out to be very important and relevant in actual simulations. But there's a very nice and simple way of understanding those once you kind of start looking at this from a mathematical perspective. So then in the fourth kind of section, I will talk about basically the manifold of matrix product states. So these matrix product states They form somehow a very low-dimensional manifold in an exponentially large Hilbert space. A Hilbert space is just a vector space. There's an exponentially large vector space and exponentially large in the number of particles, the number of spins, the number of quantities. I'm sure that Thomas explained all of you this. But these matrix Planck states form very low-dimensional representations in these very high-dimensional spaces. And what it means to work with tensor networks is to work on that manifold, okay? To basically project all the physics that you know onto that manifold and then evolving on that manifold, looking at diagonalizing your Hamiltonian on that manifold. So it turns out that this is basically the essence of all possible algorithms, okay? So all possible algorithms that actually deal with matrix Planck states are effectively kind of algorithms that you obtain by projecting your full kind of Hilbert space onto that tangent plane of the manifold. And this is what I would like to explain. There's a very nice and simple kind of expression for characterizing these manifolds, and especially also the tangent planes to these manifolds. And then the last section is a bit more specialized, but nevertheless, this might be of interest to some people in the audience. Turns out that can directly formulate these matrix Planck states ansatzes in the continuum. Okay, so you can directly kind of write down wave functions or wave functionals that do not work over discrete analysis, but actually the space is continuous. And this is basically, there's lots of progress about that field in the last years. There's lots of interesting mathematical questions, and that's why I certainly wanted to mention this. So this turns out to allow to overcome some of the fundamental problems in using the variational method for simulating quantum field theories. So this is one of the most famous talks of Feynman. One of his last talks was exactly about that problem. How do you use the variational principle? Well, the variational principle is that if you have like a matrix, then the largest eigenvalue is characterized by the vector that has the largest overlap with that matrix. Okay, so you all know these variational principles. Well, can you use such a variational principle for quantum field theories? It turns out that these continuous matrix Planck states provide you the first examples ever where it is possible to overcome all these objections of Feynman, and therefore this is opening up a new kind of way of a completely new field of using tensor networks for quantum field theories directly in the continuum. Okay, so then there's a second chapter. So please also, I forgot to say this, but if there's any question or complaint or just interrupt me. I'm very happy to answer any questions. Okay, so the second section of my lectures will deal with matrix Planck operators. So also Thomas Bartel certainly kind of talked about this already. So matrix Planck operators are very, very similar to matrix Planck states. But of course, it's like going from a vector to a matrix. Okay, so matrix Planck operators are, of course, objects that act on vectors, on matrix Planck states. And but it turns out that there's very interesting properties and that these matrix Planck operators have. And it opens up also kind of new perspectives to use these tensor networks for dealing with completely different problems. So after defining this, I will kind of give you some very simple examples as how to write down Hamiltonians as matrix Planck operators. Not so sure that Thomas did that, but I will just very quickly repeat this. But I think what he did not do is probably explain how you can also write down the equations in statistical physics, or the fundamental problems in statistical physics, in terms of such matrix Planck operators. Yeah, transfer matrices, they are also called. Turns out that this is very much tied to the tensor network language. And two of the mathematically kind of most beautiful kind of contributions or developments in these fields of both statistical physics and actually Hamiltonian physics. This is completely tied to this problem of matrix Planck operators. On the one hand, the algebraic beta ansatz. So this is something that is really a big field. So many, many people work on integrable spin systems. And there is a very simple way of understanding basically all these equations or deducing or looking at these at these problems from this different perspective, from the perspective of these of these matrix product states. And this is something that I wanted to highlight because it's so natural actually to do from the point of view of these types of networks. And that also is actually a very nice application of this fundamental theorem of matrix product states. And then actually the last section is about some non-trivial matrix product operator algebras. So this is something that we have been working a lot on also in my group in recent years. And it turns out that actually these tensor networks provide some very natural representation theory for monoidal fusion categories. Okay, so from my point of view, this mathematics involving the fusion categories is extremely kind of esoteric. It looks kind of very, very difficult because it's very abstract. Well, these tensor networks give you basically matrix representations for all these objects that they have. And that's why it turns out to be very useful then for the third part also, in which you want to describe systems in two-dimensional quantum many-body systems that have some non-trivial symmetries, that can have anions, that can have non-trivial excitations, that can be used for quantum computation. It turns out that this is completely tied to this understanding of these matrix product operator algebras. So I'm not so sure how far I will get today. This also depends probably on the questions I get. But then in the third part of the lectures, I will talk about projected entangled pair states. This is also called PEPs. In which I will, this is actually the natural definition, the natural generalization of matrix product states to the two-dimensional setting. Okay, so that's to the setting where you have not a one-dimensional chain, but where actually you work in two dimensions. But again, I'm sure that Thomas Bartel has already alluded and explained this in some detail. So again, we'll go to the definition. We will talk about the difficulties in actually defining these objects, because it turns out that there's non-trivial constraints. So some perhaps there's even there's like problems like, can you even decide whether a tensor network, whether this state is a state, can be normalized? It's maybe normalized, it's unnormalizable, all these kind of things. Turns out that there's even connections with undecidability, but I will certainly not go into this that much detail. But I will briefly talk about the complexity of contracting PEPs and also of state-of-the-art methods for actually doing this. Then I will go to the more theory part of the mathematical part of these projected entangled pair states, and we'll sketch a possible fundamental theorem of PEPs. So it turns out that for matrix product states, these one-dimensional analogs, this fundamental theorem was the key. Once we understood the fundamental theorem, there were lots and lots of possible results that followed from this. So this is still an open mathematical question. What is this most general fundamental theorem of PEPs? And it seems to be very complicated, and there's lots of facets from it. So for example, these matrix product operator algebras that I talked about at the end in section 2 are very much tied to that question of what is a fundamental theorem of PEPs. And this is actually also very much related to describing topological phases of matter. And these topological phases of matter are not that exotic, actually. These are exactly the type of systems that people want to build quantum computers with. So, and not just, you don't need a physical topological phase of matter. What you need is to basically use normal qubits like people have in Google or other kind of companies. What you are trying to do is to mimic these topological phases of matter to build quantum computers that are resilient to noise. And there's lots of interesting mathematics involved in, and that's why I decided to also include this, because it very much ties to all these ideas of the previous chapters. So there are two references that I'm giving here. So there is a review that I wrote together with Ignacio Sirac, Norbert Schuch, and David Perez Garcia just last November. So this is the archive number here. So this is on the archive. 2011-12-12-7 is basically the... So this is a long review paper of I think almost 70 pages, where the about the theory of tensor networks. So there's no numerics, there's no algorithms whatsoever. It's purely about what are the concepts, what are the symmetries, what are the theorems involved in matrix product states and PEPs. And this, of course, forms somehow the backbone, or somehow the, if you want to know more about all these things that I will tell about in this lecture, this is the go-to source. There's also another reference for some aspects. This is another review that I wrote together with Jutta Hagemann something like 5 years ago.
It's about diagonalizing transfer matrices and matrix product operators, a medley of exact and computational methods. So also there will be, there you can find actually these connections, especially the things that I will talk about, statistical physics connections to the beta ansatz, to integrability, but also to matrix product operators. And there also there are actually kind of quite a few novel algorithms for dealing with these things. Are there any objections to somehow this being the program, or are there any suggestions that I do more, or are people especially interested in some aspects of it? Please let me know, or later, I will certainly kind of try to include this into the talks. So if there's any comments or questions, please ask it now.
Sounds good. You can just start.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is a matrix product state? Well, let me kind of zoom in a little bit. I guess you can still read this. Okay, so what are matrix product states? So again, go to the lecture of Thomas Bartel. Have certainly kind of explained to you the basics, so I will go very, very quickly over this. But what is the most important kind of idea of a matrix product state? I will be concerned in these lectures with matrix product states that are uniform. Okay, so uniform matrix product states are matrix product states that are defined by one single tensor. And this tensor will kind of be, for the case of matrix product state, is kind of is a three-index tensor. And we will always write it in this notation. Okay, so this is nothing more than a tensor with three legs. So this is the notation. We will use the Einstein convention as explained by Thomas. And we will always be concerned with matrices or tensors that for which all the elements are basically complex numbers. It turns out that this is very important that these are complex numbers and not just real numbers. Okay, so this is this actually makes a huge difference if you want to describe the manifold structure of these objects. And it turns out from the interesting physics perspective, we really need the complex numbers. But for me, this is just this tensor is just a tensor with lots of elements, and all these elements are basically complex numbers. And the index I runs from 1 to d. These indices alpha and beta run from 1 to chi. Okay, and this d is typically in the application that we have in mind, although there's many mathematicians for which this is very different. But for us, typically, this d is small. So this small d is a small number, while this chi can be actually very large. Can be up the way, well, I think Thomas explained this, but it can be up to 10,000 even. And while this d is actually the dimension of the local Hilbert space, it's typically small, of course, everything I will say is independent of this thing. Oh, everything I will say is independent on somehow what is small d, what is chi, somehow everything that I will kind of, these mathematical aspects are completely independent of that. But what is a matrix product state that is uniform? Okay, so it's basically a map. It's a map from somehow this tensor, okay, that is just complex numbers, d times chi squared numbers. Of course, it's a tensor with three legs, so that's the dimension, to a Hilbert space of dimension d to the small, to the power n, with n basically the number of particles. Okay, so this Hilbert space is exponentially large, but it's just a map. It's a multilinear map that maps somehow this A such that it's everywhere the same. So this is the same as this one, is the same as this one, and so forth. And we will consider something with periodic boundary conditions. Okay, so we'll always consider in this talk at least the kind of case of periodic boundary conditions, because this makes the mathematical treatment certainly a bit simpler. Okay, so this is what the matrix product state is. It's a multilinear map that maps a tensor to somehow a tensor product structure of n d-level systems. Okay, and whether you interpret this as a quantum spin chain or as a vector in somehow a probability vector or as an other object, this is actually not very important. But in components, so somehow if you write this thing in components, you get this expression. Okay, so this is a very easy exercise, this tensor. So if you kind of label these, this is the index I1 here. This would be the index I2, I3, and so further. And if you write out what is this wave function in that basis, so this is, of course, this tensor product basis here. This tensor, well, this is, you should kind of rewrite this, but we don't do this as physicists. So it's a tensor product of I1, I2, and so further. The amplitude of that particular kind of wave function, so this is actually also called a wave function in quantum chemistry, is given by this expression. The trace of the products of these matrices, where these matrices are labeled by AI. Okay, so you can interpret this object here as a matrix with indices alpha and beta labeled by I.
Okay, and this is basically the wavefront. So what is actually very relevant and important, maybe, and relevant actually for people that have had previous lectures about tensors in this this course, is that actually the overlap with any product state. Okay, there's a different notion of decompositions of tensors. Okay, so we have a tensor with let's say n legs. Then you could in principle write this down as a product of all different objects. Okay, so this there's not even a reason that this A, this could be a different A, this could be even a different A, and so further. So the question of decomposing a certain tensor as a product of rank one tensors is of course the problem that is related to find the optimal rank R approximation to a certain tensor. So what is very easily proven, and actually I think the only reference I know is this big review paper that I just alluded to. What you can easily prove is that the overlap of any one of these product states is actually exponentially small with any one of these matrix product states. So that means that the overlap, as long as somehow this R is not exponentially large in the number of components, you need an exponential rank. So the rank of these tensors, even to approximate them, is exponential in the number of legs. And that's really the reason why we need this structure of matrix product states. Okay, so it turns out that this is exactly what is needed to describe this quantum many-body wave functions. And we cannot do it at all. There is no hope to do it with tensors with low rank in this sense. Okay, so the rank of these tensors is always exponentially large. Nevertheless, even if it's exponentially large, we can still contract and deal with these tensors in a very efficient way. Okay, so what is the most famous example of such kind of a matrix product state? It's actually called the AKLT chain. So the A stands for Affleck, K for Kennedy, L for Leap, and T for Tazaki. So these are four giants or very famous mathematical physicists that first wrote down one of these matrix product states, and they basically say, well, this D is equal to 3 here. So this is like, there's three possibilities. I have three possible states. So that means that if you have n spins, the dimension of the Hilbert space is 3 to the n. This I runs from 1, is 1, 2, or 3. And it turns out that these three matrices, okay, sigma 1 is just, these are the Pauli matrices. So for physicists, of course, you all know this, but these are the generators, basically, of the spin one half representation of SU2. So these are basically Hermitian 2x2 matrices that have 3-0, and they form a complete basis, and they have like very nice properties, but these are the Pauli matrices. Okay, so 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, minus I, 0, and 1, 0, 0, minus 1. So this is a possibility. This is the so-called AKLT chain, and this is a matrix product state that is actually very famous and has lots of nice properties, as we will see later. Okay, so this is like a multilinear map. So, of course, a matrix product state, it's not enough. This is like a vector, okay? So it's a vector in a space of C and D to the N. So, of course, we have to associate also a metric to that space. And it turns out that in quantum physics application, there's always the Euclidean metric. Okay, so we have the Euclidean metric. And, of course, you need a psi. This is a kind of a complex vector. So the we need somehow an anti-linear kind of map. That maps, of course, this A to something that is the conjugate, such that the inner product is basically positive definite. Well, somehow we just write this down as this kind of object. So the only difference between this thing here and this thing here is that here we kind of write down the indices downwards, here we write the indices upwards. Okay, and this is actually nothing more than this thing, if you kind of look at this. So this tensor here is defined as a function of this, and what this bar means is just takes the elements-wise complex conjugate of these tensors. So so real mathematicians will probably complain that this is kind of the conjugate of a matrix is not defined. You have to kind of work in a certain basis. That's completely correct. We work in a certain basis. So by choosing somehow a matrix product state representation, you chose indeed a basis in which to work, namely this basis labeled by alpha and beta. But then, of course, the complex conjugate is completely well defined. And there is, of course, there are ways of changing basis, and it's all kind of not, this is actually not a problem whatsoever. Okay, once we have this Euclidean in a product, we can, for example, take the overlap between two wave functions. Okay, so this is the overlap between two wave functions in a D to the N dimensional Hilbert space. So this Hilbert space is exponentially large. If you kind of take the overlap between these two things, you just have to contract, let's say, this index here with the index that we had here. We use the Einstein sum convention, and what you get is exactly somehow something of this form. Okay, so we have to contract that tensor network. And if you look carefully at this, even somehow this is the norm of a wave function in an exponentially large Hilbert space, there's a very simple way of doing this. There's a very simple way of defining what this object is. You see that this is like the B tensor, this is the A tensor. It's always the same, B, A tensor, or B, A bar actually. So you see that if I would define this as a matrix, so I can really define this object here. Okay, so this is this B and then the A bar here. I can just define this as a matrix E, okay, where these are the left indices and these are the right indices. This is therefore nothing more than the trace of E to the power N. Okay, because you see, I'm just repeating this matrix is the same as this matrix, is the same as this matrix. And I can multiply these matrices. This is exactly what is going on in the Einstein convention. So the norm or the overlap between these two wave functions is nothing more than that object, the trace of some object. And of course, this E is element somehow of your Hilbert space is basically C chi squared times chi squared. That's the dimension of that object. Okay, so this is this transfer matrix. Of course, if you take the norm of a wave function, A and B have to be equal to each other, and you get this so-called transfer matrix E. That is, well, actually, as we will see momentarily, is actually has very interesting properties. This is really the quantum generalization of a stochastic map. Okay, so this E will turn out to be related to completely positive maps and will have very nice properties that are called the quantum Peron-Frobenius theorem, and all these kind of things apply. But before we do this, let's just quickly check what this object is in the case of AKLT. So in the case of AKLT, these AIs are still written down here. This was sigma 1, of course. This is equal to A1. This is equal to A2. This is equal to A3. You plug this in, you kind of just take the tensor product of these objects. You get a 4x4 matrix with plenty of zeros, but then there's a few ones, minus ones and twos. And you can immediately see, of course, that there is a leading eigenvalue of this matrix. You just have to diagonalize, of course, this 1, 2, 2, 1. There's an eigenvalue 3, and there's actually three eigenvalues minus 1. So you see immediately that if I take the trace of that matrix to a very large power n, of course, only the leading eigenvector will remain. Okay, so all these three kind of smaller eigenvalues, they're smaller in modulus and absolute value, they will kind of exponentially kind of wash down. So you know that in the limit of n very large, the norm of that state will actually be 3 to the n. Okay, so of course, plus some corrections that are kind of exponentially in the system size n. Okay, because you know that if you take a trace of a matrix to a very large power, this power is large. Basically, the only thing that survives is the subspace of the leading eigenvectors in magnitude. And in this particular case, this is this 3, and all the rest will exponentially decay. Okay, and this turns out to be crucial, of course, as you have seen probably in the lectures of Thomas, to understand indeed somehow what is this eigenstructure of this transfer matrix. Okay, so let's assume for the moment, because we can actually do this. There's actually a mathematically well-defined way to immediately take the thermodynamic limits. So take n, actually the number of sides to infinity, we can still perfectly well define these matrix product states and all the properties that are related to them. So, so if we take the thermodynamic limits n going to infinity, as I said, the norm is kind of this wave function is completely determined by the leading eigenvector lambda zero of that transfer matrix. Okay, so that transfer matrix, this kind of object here, okay, so has eigenvectors. Okay, and the eigenvectors, well, you can kind of find, of course, if there's a left eigen. So this is not a Hermitian matrix, okay, by the way. So this E, where kind of you have indices from left to right, this is not at all a Hermitian matrix, but nevertheless, it is a matrix with very special properties, as we will see momentarily. But somehow it turns out that it will have that the leading eigenvectors of this will always be able, you will always be able to choose them real. So there will always be an eigenvalue that is real that has the largest magnitude. And there will be a left kind of eigenvector associated to this and a right eigenvector. Okay, so if you kind of write this down, so apologies, so this has to be this. Somehow in this graphical notation, a left and a right eigenvector is really, so this is my transfer matrix here. This is my
this object here is my transfer matrix, and I multiply from the left with the vector, and I get somehow, again, the same object at the right-hand side. And especially the same, of course, if you multiply from the right-hand side, this will be the right eigenvector, you get something proportional to this. So if you write this down in these components, actually, so this turns out to be equal to this. So what you have is basically the sum over I AI dagger rho left AI is equal to lambda zero rho left. If you interpret this object here, because this rho left is of course a vector with two indices, I can always interpret that object as a matrix. Okay, there's no limitations. If I have like a tensor with two legs, I can either say it's a vector or I can say it's a matrix. It does not really matter. And if I interpret this as a matrix, what I see is that the condition that this is a left eigenvector is equivalent to this condition. That if I act with somehow the sum over I AI dagger on this row left AI, I get again something proportional to somehow the same matrix. It turns out that this structure is something that is called a completely positive map. Okay, so this is called a completely positive map. This is really the quantum generalization of a stochastic map. Okay, so this is like a quantum stochastic map. And therefore, somehow it turns out that it's not completely obvious, although it's also not very hard. It's possible to generalize all these ideas of stochastic maps to this quantum regime. So why is it somehow, why is this called a completely positive map? Well, it's clear that if rho left is a positive definite operator, well, what you do here is take a sum over I and kind of left conjugating with AI dagger and AI. Well, if rho left is positive, then AI dagger rho left AI is also a positive operator. A positive semi-definite operator, and then take the mixture of semi-definite positive operators is still positive semi-definite. So that means that if you start here with a positive operator, you always end up with a positive operator. That's exactly the same as you have in stochastic matrices. By a stochastic matrix that I multiply with a vector with only with a probability distribution with only positive coefficients, what comes out is also positive. This turns out to be the quantum generalization of this kind of this idea. And of course, somehow this right eigenvector has actually the opposite. So the only thing you have to kind of exchange the roles of this AI and AI dagger, you see somehow this is basically the right eigenvector has the property that some AI row right AI dagger is equal to proportional to row right. Okay, so this is, well, we know that this is the structure, this is underlying these matrix product states. So let's actually consider or study a little bit what happens.
So Frank, sorry to interrupt. There is a question from
yes.
The
meeting.
So sorry, super quick. When you say stochastic matrix, do you mean, classically, do you mean a matrix where like the row sum is one?
Yes. Okay, so
But your completely positive map, that's not unital, right? It's neither unital nor is it trace preserving.
No,
right?
Indeed. So I was using a misnomer. So actually, a stochastic, the really analog of a stochastic map is a trace preserving completely positive map. So that actually means that the row right has to be equal to the L entity. So this is like the stochastic map. What I should say is actually a positive matrix. So it's like a matrix with only positive entries.
Okay, and, so you're not assuming that it's trace preserving here, right?
I'm not assuming it, but it will turn out that there will always be a choice of these AIs that I can
okay, okay.
But indeed, I'm not assuming it for the moment, for sure not. Okay, and I'm not assuming this, but this is indeed, this is the analog of what you have classically is like a matrix with only non-negative entries. Okay, and actually this whole Perron-Frobenius theory applies to these matrices, and this will be somehow the quantum version of that. Okay, so let me kind of say what in words what this kind of thing is. So of course, for having in the classical case when you kind of deal with these stochastic or positive matrices, there's some notions of ergodicity. Okay, so basically, you say that a stochastic map or a positive map is ergodic if you can start with any kind of entry in your probability vector, and then there's a finite chance that you will kind of visit any of the other entries. again, if you're ergodic, then something that is actually very easy to prove is the Perron-Frobenius theory, and it tells you that actually that if this is true, then there will be an eigenvector with a positive eigenvalue, and this eigenvalue will be the largest one in magnitude of all of them, such that this eigenvector corresponding to it has only positive entries. That's for the classical matrix case. The quantum version of this is the following. This is basically underlying the whole theory of matrix product states. Okay, so first of all, we have to define what does it mean to be ergodic. Okay, so I have this set of matrices AI, and I have to define what is somehow the analog of ergodicity. Well, it actually means that if I take random, I take products of all these matrices with each other, like AI1 with times AI2 times, and I can choose somehow these I's completely like I want, that actually, if you kind of take products and then you take the union of all the objects that I get by taking products of these matrices, that actually span the whole matrix algebra. But at the end, I can write down any matrix that is kind of chi by chi, because these are these AIs or all matrices in basically C chi by chi, that any matrix can be written down as a linear combination of kind of products of this kind. Okay, so this is, because of course, this I is simply, like I said, is very small. No? There's very few indices here, so this is not an obvious requirement. But for example, these Pauli matrices that we have seen before, they certainly satisfy that rule. Okay, so it happens that if this AI satisfy this rule or this ergodicity, then the leading eigenvalue of this matrix AE can be chosen to be real and positive, and the corresponding density matrix that was the fixed point of this, so both the row left and the row right, will actually be positive semi-definite. Okay, so this is really the analog of the classical Perron-Frobenius theory. Okay, that actually, the Perron-Frobenius tells more, also the quantum tells more, that if there are other kind of eigenvalues with modulos, the same modulus as somehow this largest real modulus, that is lambda zero, somehow this lambda zero is the leading eigenvalue that was positive, they are all of the form basically the same, this maximum one, times a phase that is actually a fraction of one. Okay, so this P and Q are of course equal to elements of Z actually, or even. So you have to, so it's possible to prove that all the eigenvalues, if you satisfy this ergodicity property, they lie basically on the leading eigenvalues lie on the unit circle, and it turns out that they're all kind of roots of the identity with just a rational kind of expression. Okay, and then there turns out to be some more restraint or some more constrained kind of condition, and this is what you call classically primitivity. Well, there's also quantum primitivity. What you say is actually that you do a little bit more than what we required here. We don't say that actually they span the full matrix algebra. What you say is that there is a finite k. Okay, there's really a finite k, and if I take products of these matrices, always the product of k of these matrices, that this still span the whole matrix algebra. Okay, so this is a bit of a more restrictive, this is a more kind of restrictive condition. And if you do this, then you can actually prove that there's a unique eigenvalue with the largest modulus, and all the other eigenvalues are strictly smaller than that one in magnitude. Okay, so this is a this is really the analog of a primitive map in this whole kind of classical Perron-Frobenius setting, in which somehow, if you're primitive, then you basically, this is about mixing Markov chains. This is, of course, a central result there, that if you're primitive, that there's unique fixed point. Well, this is really kind of the quantum analog of this. And turned out to be a very non-trivial problem.
Frank, excuse me, we have another question in the chat by JM.
Yes?
Hi, Frank. So I don't understand. It's always going to be the case that there's some finite k that you, because we're in a finite dimensional vector space, so you don't need infinite numbers of these AIs to
span. No, but I could give you an example. Okay, so take, for example, just take one A. Okay, take it equal to sigma x. Okay, so sigma x. Then, of course, if you have A squared, this is the identity. And so we see that actually, if you take the union of A and A squared, I get actually an algebra that spans both by X and the identity. But if I take a fixed K, then I either, if X is odd, I will always get X. And if it's even, I only get the identity.
Okay, so I see. I thought you said at most K. You mean
no,
exactly.
No, for fixed. So there's a fixed K here.
But you don't allow smaller ones.
No, I don't allow for smaller ones.
Okay, I got it now. Thanks.
This turns out to be the analog of basically the notion of primitivity, and then so it was a not trivial problem. So actually, this in classical stochastic matrices, there's something called the Wieland theorem. Okay, so if I give you an n by n matrix that is actually primitive, is there an upper bound that I can give on the power that I have to take such that this matrix to that power has only positive entries? Okay, so this is really the famous theorem in linear algebra. It's called the Wieland theorem, and you can find actually this condition. Well, there was a non-trivial problem to do the same thing for this quantum, okay, for this quantum Markov chain. So is there actually for a fixed bond dimension, actually I should not call this D, but actually chi. So for a fixed bond dimension chi, is there actually an upper bound that you can formulate in the power or the number of kind of times you have to apply this CP map before you are guaranteed that the state that will come out is positive definite and not positive semi-definite? It turns out that this bound is actually 3 times chi to the 5. But all of these results can certainly be found in this review that I alluded to in the beginning. Okay, so this is the underlying basically all the mathematics and the manipulations that Thomas Bartel talked about in his lectures about finding basically these eigenvector values. Suddenly, if you kind of do IDMRG, this algorithms for DMRG in a Terraform limit, you're implicitly assuming that somehow all the states that you're using satisfy this primitivity. Okay, so it turns out that if you don't assume this, if you don't kind of require this primitivity, then actually these algorithms will kind of blow up. They will just not work. But fortunately, if you kind of take a random MPS, okay, if you take a random state, random kind of matrices AI, they will actually always satisfy this primitive condition. Okay, so that's why actually in practice, if you do numerics, you would kind of be extremely unlucky to actually not end up with the primitive one, although that actually happens. That happens for cases if you, for example, use real numbers instead of complex numbers. It turns out that if you do optimizations with matrix product states, especially these uniform matrix product states, and you restrict yourself to real matrices, that you kind of can converge to situations in which you will be not primitive anymore, and then actually your algorithm will not work anymore, it will blow up, and somehow something strange will happen. So that's one of the reasons. Well, I will kind of talk about this more later, but that's why it's very important that we work over the complex numbers. Okay, so let's kind of look at some nice application of this. Okay, so again, what this means is that once you are a primitive NPS, it's also called injective NPS actually, then there's a unique largest eigenvalue, a left one and a right eigenvector. Okay, so these objects are basically unique and can be chosen to be positive definite. So let's kind of try to relate these row left and row right kind of matrices, or these positive density matrices, to the entanglement spectrum of an MPS. So Thomas talked a lot about entanglement and entangled entropy and so further. Let's actually calculate the entanglement spectrum of such an MPS. So what is actually this entanglement spectrum? So what you take is basically an MPS. Okay, so this was kind of psi of A. And you also had like the conjugate. And what I will do is trace out part of the system. So I will kind of trace out all, somehow I will kind of take the sum over these indices all the way somehow from site, but this could be site zero or something. That's from site zero to minus infinity. But I will leave open all these indices on the right-hand side. Okay, and this defines something that is called a density matrix. And I call this density matrix the entanglement spectrum density matrix. Okay, this is really like for people that are more knowledgeable about quantum mechanics. If you have a pure state, kind of typically like this. And this is a state defined over subsystem AB. And you trace out subsystem A. This is equal to rho b. Okay, so this is really how this is defined as the partial trace of density matrix. And density matrices are kind of everywhere in quantum systems. And these are the ones that are actually important. Well, we are interested in the eigenvalues of such objects. Okay, because the eigenvalues of this density matrix are exactly these. They form somehow this entanglement spectrum, or the square roots of these eigenvalues are actually the Schmidt coefficients that Thomas talked about a lot. So let's kind of try to do this. Let's try to see what comes out. I have this state. But of course, I know that on the left-hand side here, I have this matrix repeated infinitely many times.
And there's a leading eigenvalue, all the other ones are kind of sub-leading, so I can immediately replace that kind of thing with row left. Okay, and I'm actually assuming, of course, that the eigenvalue corresponding to it is equal to one, otherwise the state is not normalized. Turns out in quantum mechanics, states have to be normalized, but anyway, we are. This is kind of a, you can always kind of just multiply all these all the matrices with a constant, the same constant, such that indeed the norm of these states is one. Okay, so you can replace immediately this whole kind of infinite, this half infinite kind of product of all these E's by this row left. Okay, so this is exactly because it's the leading eigenvector of this. Okay, so then you see that this matrix here that we have is basically the sum over alpha, beta times this, where somehow I put an alpha here. So this index here is an alpha, this index is a beta, and I kind of define my psi beta as being somehow everything that is to the right of this. So this is basically psi beta, where this index is fixed to the value beta. Same thing here, this is basically psi alpha, but somehow this index you fix on alpha and all the rest is still open. So you see this matrix here that I write down is really equal to somehow the product of these objects. Okay, so I have something like here, this psi beta, I will interpret this as somehow a bra, while this psi beta is a cat. I put this row is an operator, I put it in the middle, and somehow this alpha, of course, acts on that. This is here, and then I have my kind of bra again on the right-hand side. Okay, so this is this matrix. I'm interested in finding the eigenvalues of that matrix. So this is basically what I'm doing. I'm trying to find eigenvalues of the product of this matrix times this matrix times this matrix. But of course, there's this beautiful kind of trivial fact that with eigenvalues, now if I have two matrices, A times B, then they are always, the eigenvalues that are non-zero are always guaranteed to be also eigenvalues of B times A. So if you're interested in the non-zero eigenvalues of somehow the product of two matrices, you can as well take the product in the other way. It's kind of a completely trivial fact to prove, but it's very non-trivial to apply it here, because that means that basically if I interpret everything here, this whole thing here as A, and this as B, I can put B on the right-hand side, and what I get is actually this here. Alpha is now on the outside. Now I get basically the inner product of this psi alpha and psi beta times a beta, and this is all right. But if you look carefully at this, this is, of course, nothing more than this row right. This turns out to be the right eigenvector of that completely positive map that I wrote down. And therefore, the eigenvalues of this MPS are nothing more than the eigenvalues of the product of somehow this both this row left and this row right. These are two positive operators, therefore all these eigenvalues are positive and actually satisfy all the rules that you want. And this is how you calculate this entanglement spectrum. So you see that actually the number of non-zero eigenvalues, although this is an object that is actually an infinite by infinite matrix, it's really infinitely large because n goes to infinity. You know? So nevertheless, it's an extremely low rank object. So that's the non-zero eigenvalues are actually given by the eigenvalues of the product of these matrices, and both of these matrices actually are element of C chi by chi. Okay, so there's at most chi different eigenvalues for this kind of object, and this is the entanglement spectrum. So I'm just repeating probably what Thomas kind of already told, but this is important for setting the setting for actually what I want to tell later. Okay, so let's kind of go to the second part. I'm going a little bit slower than anticipated because we are just on the second section. Okay, for the first part. So I will have to probably speed up or, well, let's see what we talk. Okay, so, but please continue asking questions. No, I'm not, I don't want to limit you in that respect. So something that is very nice to see is actually that these matrix product states, as we saw, that's like a simple tensor here, okay, with a three-level kind of a three-leg tensor with three indices that defines a many-body state in a Hilbert space of dimension d to the m, or d to the n, where n can even be infinity. Okay, but it turns out that this is actually a many-to-one map, okay, although this Hilbert space is much larger than this one. Nevertheless, many, many matrices here correspond to exactly the same MPS on the right-hand side.
Okay, it turns out that if you work this out in terms of algebraic geometry or geometry, differential geometry, sorry, it turns out that it has a structure of a fiber bundle. It actually turns out also to be a Kähler manifold, but we will come back to this later. And what is this kind of why is it that this is a many-to-one correspondence? Well, it's because if I have a certain set of matrices AI, and I conjugate all of those with an X, so I kind of replace the AIs with X minus one times AI times X, and of course, I'm assuming till either an infinite system or one with periodic boundary condition, then actually these are exactly the same states. Why is this? Well, we saw that the matrix product state is actually can be written as the trace of AI1, AI2, and so further. And of course, if I put the resolution of the identity here, I will have an X times an X minus one. These things will disappear. And you see that indeed the wave function is completely independent of this X. Okay, so these X's are actually crucial also in algorithms. Okay, algorithms to deal with matrix product states, they are kind of used all the time. Okay, so it turns out that, well, it means that if I have an AI and that's a matrix product state AI, it's completely equivalent to an AI tilde. Okay, so they are basically corresponding to the same state. So this green line here are indeed all the somehow the MPS tensors that are equivalent somehow up to somehow an invertible matrix X. Of course, this X has to be invertible, okay, but that's the only condition. Just take an arbitrary invertible X, multiply, take a similarity transformation of somehow these AIs with respect to that basis, and of course, this is actually exactly the same state. So these are this is this green line, and we call actually these X's gauge transforms. That's why it's that green. We call it gauges. This turns out to be gauge transforms because if you kind of will do this in actually also for one dimension, but especially in higher dimensions, these objects that you have here will kind of play the, well, you will be able to interpret them as actually as gauge bosons in your theory. Okay, but this is going too far. I will certainly not go to this, but there's a very clear connection actually between these X's and something that's called gauging, gauge theories in physics. But anyway, so if you have such an X, then it is possible to define matrix product states in canonical form, okay? Because we have now many states, okay? All these green ones, all the ones that lie in this green line are basically corresponding to the same state here on the right-hand side. The question is there a nice one? Is there a particularly interesting parametrization of that state? And turns out that this is true. There is one. Turns out that you can always choose a gauge such that either this row left that we defined or this row right is equal to the identity. Okay. So it's easy to see. If I do such a gauge transform from this to this, this row left and row right are not invariant under this. Okay. So these row left and row right were the left and the right eigenvector of that completely positive map. And if you do such a gauge transform, the row left will transform according to this, the row right will transform according to this transformation. As you see, actually, of course, as should be, all the physical properties should be completely invariant under such a gauge transform. And indeed, the eigenvalues, the entanglement spectrum was actually only dependent on the eigenvalues of row left times row right. And this is exactly somehow perfectly okay, because I have an X here, an X minus one there, an X minus dagger here, an X dagger there. So of course, the entanglement spectrum is actually completely invariant under such gauge transforms. Okay, but because somehow these row lefts and row rights transform according to this, you can always, well, certainly if you're in this injective case in which this row left is, of course, positive definite, you can always choose this gauge equal to, let's say, row left minus 1/2, and then this row left actually becomes row left tilde, actually becomes the identity. And that's what we kind of write here in this notation. So now this is the identity matrix. Okay, there's nothing there. Just identify this leg with this leg. And then you get this is effectively somehow this tensor notation saying that this identity is the left eigenvector of that transfer matrix. And of course, by choosing a different gauge, you can actually kind of go to the to bring it in the right canonical form, such that the right kind of fixed point is the identity matrix. And that means that actually it turns out that actually the most useful way of writing down an MPS, both in the finite but especially in the infinite case, is actually some mixed form. So at the end, this matrix product state, it turns out, well, they are all equivalent. And so if you bring this A left, so if you bring it in the left canonical form, for which this happens, this is the red kind of case, this case will be the blue case. Of course, for any matrix product state, can either bring it in this left or the right, but not both. Okay, so what I do is typically choose a site, the site on which I will optimize. And everything to the left of it, I bring in the left canonical gauge. And everything to the right of it, I bring in the right canonical gauge. So this is the red and the blue gauge. Okay, and then somehow the center side, or somehow the side that remains here, the green one, is called A center, and is of course related to somehow this AI by a row left one half, AI row right one half. Okay, but this is for any AI, there's always somehow this way of transforming it to this canonical gauge. This will turn out to be the really useful gauge for doing simulations, for doing optimization, for doing everything. And this is effectively the gauge that is always used in DMRG algorithms. Okay, so now we are, this is just some kind of preliminary kind of things. We have indeed this whole notion that that two states are equivalent if somehow, if this happens, if two MPSs are related by such a gauge transform, they are certainly equivalent. Question is there also a converse? Okay, so what happens if I kind of impose that Psi A is equal to Psi B? Okay, so I impose this one. Is that also implying, is there somehow what we proved is actually this is trivial to prove. Okay, this is just look at the formulas and this happens. That there exists somehow such a gauge that they are equivalent. Well, of course, these two states are equal. But somehow what is very non-trivial is the right-hand side of that formula. So if psi of A is equal to psi of B, then it follows that there actually exists a phase and there exists a matrix such that X times A is equal to e to the I phi B times X. Of course, you can as well write this as A is equal to X minus 1 times B times X up to this phase e to the I phi. Okay, but that's of course equivalent to this if this X is invertible. Okay, so this is actually the fundamental theorem of matrix product states. I see that I actually forgot to prove it here in these lecture notes. So maybe I can kind of try to recall how to prove it, because that's actually a beautiful, the proof is very simple. It's just a very simple application of Cauchy-Schwarz. And that's why it might be useful to actually kind of go to this and in very detail, small detail, because it is actually just actually two lines to prove this theorem. And it's really, it forms the basis really of lots of, so I do this. Can I kind of increase? Not working quite. Why is this not working? To apologize, I want to kind of add some space.
In the meantime, can you also ask a question while you fiddle with your smart board? Sure. Dina, question.
Yes, so I wanted to ask if it's possible to repeat the statement of the fundamental theorem.
Yes, I will, yes. Because indeed it's not very, I have to apologize, it's not very clear. And my board doesn't seem to be very reactive. Maybe it has to do with Zoom, I don't know. okay, so what is the fundamental theorem? It tells you like I have a state, I have an MPS determined by matrices A. I have psi of A. And I have another one, B, and I have the premise that they are equal to each other. I know that these two states are globally equal to each other. Okay, so as a state on the Hilbert space, so I have this big Hilbert space, okay, and I have this with all tensors A, I know that as a state, these things are equal. The question is there a relationship that we can find between these tensors? Okay, so it's obvious that if these A and B are related to each other by similarity transforms, then of course these two states will be equal. But the question is the converse also true? Okay, and this is highly not obvious that this is actually that this is possible. A priori you don't know this. Okay, there might be some kind of very non-trivial, non-local transformations that actually still kind of allow you to see that two states are equal to each other. But that turns out to be not the case. Is that clear? And the statement is then that this is true if and only if, and this is the whole idea of tensor networks. You have global statements about your full Hilbert space with all these spin chairs, these infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces. Nevertheless, you're able to reduce these questions to local problems. So what you say is that this is true if and only if there exists an X. Let me kind of forget about the phi because this is not very important, such that this A, this tensor A, is equal to X minus one times this tensor P times X. Or of course, equivalently, all the matrices AI are equal to X minus one times BI times X, with this X, of course, independent of I.
So this is the claim that this is an if and only if case. Again, this was actually, this insight was the key, as I will show you in a minute, in classifying actually all possible phases of matter, quantum phases of matter in one dimension. Well, to note that this is completely based on actually this fundamental theorem of matrix product states. Okay, so let's. How do you prove this? It's actually that's very small. That's very easy actually. If I say psi of A is equal to psi of B, well, that means, as we have seen, that the overlap, if I kind of have an A here and I have somehow this other tensor B bar there, then that matrix must have an eigenvalue 1. Okay, because I normalize my states, and if somehow these two states are equal to each other, that means that the two overlap between these two states must have modulus 1. So that's only possible if this matrix that I just wrote down, and matrix where you kind of interpret these two indices as the left indices, these two the right indices, there must exist an x such that this is equal to e to the I phi times x. Okay, that's the only possibility, because if I kind of have these MVSs, I take the overlap between them. This is basically this matrix to the infinite power, the trace of that. And of course, if this is injective, there's actually a unique fixed point. And you can actually easily prove that this is true if and only if there exists an X for which that has an eigen, that has a, that, and there's an eigenvector of that matrix with modulus equal to
0.05.
Sorry, was there a comment there?
So another question from Adana.
Yes. So I wanted to ask, is there any restriction on the subgroup of GLN where X can come from, or it can be any arbitrary member?
No, it's completely arbitrary. It just has to be, it has to have determinant. Well, it can restrict indeed to determinant 1, of course, yes. No, there's no restriction besides that. So also, let's assume that this A is
a rational. Sorry to interrupt again. So we also have a question from JM.
Yes.
Actually, several questions. So first of all, this is only the infinite case, to be sure.
Yes, because otherwise it doesn't make sense to think about eigenvalues. Of course, if it's if you're in a finite MPS, well, it's a product of matrices, but there's no restriction at all that these are all the same. So yes, this is really about the infinite case. But this is the setting that is interesting from the physics point of view.
Okay, but also the case where you have more than one A, even in the infinite, where it has some period, is the same result still hold?
No. No, it doesn't hold in that case. You have to be very careful. This is actually, but yes, it holds. This is exactly what for this you have to actually do this. Okay, let me go back to this. I promise I will kind of treat this case for you later. Okay, it turns out that actually if you're in that case that you're talking about, let me already kind of give you the answer. Actually, it's true in the general case indeed. So what you need is this ergodic case, and if you have ergodic in the ergodic cases, what turns out that this AIs, well, they do not span the full matrix algebra, because that's otherwise it would have been primitive. And it turns out that there's always a basis in which your all AI, all the AIs can be written down in this block form, in which you basically have a matrix here, a matrix here, and an off-diagonal block XI there. But now if you take the trace of matrices like that, it's very clear that these XIs will never play a role, okay? Because you take the trace of matrices of that form here, this X will never play a role because it will only affect the off-diagonal elements. And therefore, from an MPS point of view, because you take the trace of the product of these matrices, this tensor is actually equal to this tensor, okay? So you have manually, you have to kind of put the off-diagonal blocks equal to zero, okay? Because they're non-visible, these XIs are non-visible. And therefore, somehow, that's why I say, okay, this theorem is actually true only for matrices AI and BI that are in canonical form. That means that all these off-diagonal blocks, you have put them equal to zero. So once you put all these blocks equal to zero, then actually it's true. Then again, there exists an X for which this holds. Okay, so you first have to be a little bit careful. You have to kind of look at the matrix algebra. Somehow this off-diagonal parts, you have to manually
put them equal to zero because they really are completely they play no role somehow. The psi of A, this state, the global state that we have here, cannot see this X, is completely independent of this X. And therefore, we actually have to manually put it equal to zero. And then there will exist somehow a gauge transform that will relate this canonical form of A to the canonical form of B. I hope that answers your question.
Mostly, thanks.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm just assuming that this X is the eigenvector with eigenvalue with modulus 1 from the AB. Somehow this rho is the eigenvector with eigenvalue 1 from somehow my MPS rho. I'm actually assuming that A is in the right canonical form, so that A bar this is equal to the identity. So this is the identity matrix, is the eigenvector from the right hand side. And now I will kind of do some Cauchy-Schwarz. So sorry that I have to cram it here because it seems to be that Zoom doesn't allow me to create lots of new space here. So let me kind of look at the following tensor network contraction diagram. I have square root of rho. So this is rho is of course a positive matrix, so I can take the square root. Take a square root of rho here. I take an A here. I take a B bar here. I take a square root of rho times x there. So this is just a product of these two matrices. And I close this here, and I put the x here. Okay, so you can ask, why are you doing this? Well, this is just a contraction of a tensor network. Okay, so this is a scalar. This is just one number. What I will do now is Cauchy-Schwarz. So of course, so this is actually the inner product of two vectors. And I will consider the vectors to be the first of all, the vector on the top, which is called involves the square root of rho A and X. This is one vector, and the other vector is this one times this. Okay, so I know basically that this thing is guaranteed to be smaller than, let's take this thing squared. Then I know because of Cauchy-Schwarz that this is smaller than, of course, the norm of the top times the norm of the bottom. And the norm of the bottom of the top is basically this matrix A. Then I have square root of rho times square root of rho, so I'll get a rho here. I will get an A bar here. And then on the right-hand side, I get basically the X and the X bar. Okay, so this is really the norm of this upper part. So if I take this part here, and you take the Euclidean norm of that vector, you get exactly this kind of thing. And now I will do the same thing for the bottom. The bottom part is actually equal to what I get here is x dagger rho x times b bar times the identity. And I was assuming that both of them were right in the right canonical form. But what you will see is that, of course, well, this rho is the eigenvector. So this thing here, this is an eigenvector. So this is equal to rho x, x bar. And this is also equal to this because this bb, so basically this is also equal to x dagger rho x. Somehow, when I kind of take this thing all around, so the trace, so I get always the same thing. I get somehow that both this is x, the trace of x rho x dagger. This is the trace of x dagger rho x. And this is, well, maybe I've messed up my x's and x daggers, but it doesn't matter. And if you calculate what this thing is on the left-hand side, it's actually also equal to that, okay? Because we assumed that this x was this eigenvector of AB with eigenvalue 1. You plug somehow this value in, and you see that this is also equal to the left-hand side. So that means that, of course, the inner product of Cauchy-Schwarz is only satisfied, saturated, if somehow the top is equal to the bottom. And if you write this out, you get exactly somehow this property here. Okay, that this is possible if and only if A and B are connected to each other by a similarity transform. Okay, so this is actually, this is cool. Okay, so it means it's an if and only if. This is holding. So the proof I gave here is a simplistic proof that actually only holds in the injective case, in the primitive case. You can extend it. And as I said, somehow this is, for this, you have to be a little bit careful with these canonical forms. But once you do all of this, this is kind of perfectly working. And it's actually kind of very powerful, as you will see later. Okay, so let me try to hide this. Unless there's questions about this.
Okay, so let's apply this to a very important kind of case of matrix product states or of tacit networks in general.
Frank, you were a bit quicker in continuing than Edina had a chance to ask his question.
Yes, please.
So I wanted to ask whether there was a physics interpretation to this X that conjugates A into B.
Sarah. Nothing. There's no physical meaning whatsoever. That's why it's called the gauge transform. It has no physical implication. That's the whole point. It is actually not. It's not physical. It's completely invisible. You cannot see it. But you will immediately see that it actually has very strong. The fact that such an X exists actually has very strong physical kind of implications. This is exactly what I want to kind of tell you. So it's invisible. What it is, the gauge is invisible, but nevertheless. The fact that there is such a gauge transform will allow you to classify the different phases of matter, which is, well, it's not visible, but nevertheless, it's very important. So there's no physical, to the X itself, there's no meaning, actually. But let me give the example, and then maybe things will become much more clear. Okay, so what is an important case of an important case of this? So when we say psi of A is equal to psi of B, well, actually, what happens is in many, many cases, I'm interested in spin chains. Okay, so these are represented by, let's say, this MPS. And if I multiply every one of these indices with the same unitary out of some kind of group, so I have certain group G, and I have kind of a representation of that group, UG, and I multiply every side basically of my system with that same unitary, then it remains invariant. Okay, so it remains somehow this thing is equal to itself. Okay, so it turns out that this is actually very easy to see. If your Hamiltonian, the matrix for which this is the ground state, has all the symmetries, is for example symmetric under SU2 or SO3 or whatever transformation, and the ground state is unique, then it's of course you all know that the eigenvectors, if the eigenspaces are kind of one-dimensional, then all these eigenvectors kind of completely inherit all the symmetries of your matrix. Yeah, and this is basically why this is so relevant. It turns out that many of the interactions in nature are actually kind of symmetric, especially SO3, SU2, all these interactions are very kind of relevant. Okay, so that means that I start from how this premise, that there exists a group G and a representation U of G of that group that is implemented on my spin chain for which somehow my state is invariant. And I would like to understand how can this be implemented? What are the different ways in which somehow I can write down such MPSs? Okay. So we can immediately use somehow the fundamental theorem. Okay. It turns out that, of course, somehow in this particular case, this A is equal to this times UG. This is A. And the B is, of course, just the original one. Okay, so that means that there must exist a phase. Again, this phase we will kind of ignore for the moment, but there exists a matrix that is full rank or determinant one, for which somehow this UG is e to the phi times somehow the similarity transform that you apply on the B. Okay, but now it becomes really interesting. Of course, this U of G forms a representation of a certain group. Okay, that means that if I multiply two of these kind of unitaries, well, I get a new unitary labeled by somehow the new group element, which is the product of these two group elements. So what I must have is that, of course, the same thing happens on the right-hand side. Otherwise, somehow this would not be consistent. If somehow this MPS is injective, then I must for sure have that the product of these two matrices is also equal somehow to this XG1 times G2. But this is not quite true. Why? Because somehow you always get the X of G together with the XG minus one. So they always come in pairs. Okay? It's not that you just get an XG, you always get an XG minus one too. That means that actually if somehow these X's would be such that if you multiply them, I get indeed X of G1 times G2 up to a phase, this is perfectly fine. Okay, this is still not in violation whatsoever with this fundamental theorem. And this is exactly what happens, and this is exactly what classifies the different phases of matter in 1D. It will turn out that actually for a given group, there are kind of always a finite number of different projective representations. Okay, so it's actually, for people that have never done this, this is actually a very nice exercise in linear algebra. So given a certain group, kind of find all the projective representations. So just as an exercise, what you need to use is the so-called Schmidt normal form. Not the Schmidt, but Schmidt normal form, and with this you can immediately find basically all the projective representations. representation of a certain finite group. But this is an extremely well-studied topic in group theory. Given a certain group, what are all the projective representations of this group? That means these X's do not form a representation. They only form a representation of that group up to a phase, with this omega depends on G1 and G2. There's very easy conditions now because of associativity. You can formulate very easy conditions on this omega that what they have to satisfy. And this actually you can turn it into a linear problem. And you can solve basically this linear problem, and that gives you all the possible solutions to this kind of quantity. Okay, so it turns out that indeed, this is exactly what happens with these X of Gs. So this X of Gs can actually be, certainly if this is a group, can be projective representations of your given group, and of course there's a kind of a topological index associated to these indices. I'm not so sure whether I kind of I will certainly kind of write down later what this has to do. This has actually to do with group cohomology, but it turns out that there's only, so to every projective representation you can associate an index. And of course, if you have nice and smooth deformations of an MPS, you can never kind of change an integer index. You cannot change that in a kind of a nice continuous way. It turns out, therefore, that all the MPSs that will be kind of will transform according to different projective representations will actually belong to different phases of matter. Okay, but I will certainly come to that.
So, Frank, sorry to interrupt. We have another question from Dima.
Yes.
So, to clarify, I think you said this, but these projective representations are the same thing as two cocycles with values in the circle, right?
Yes, that's exact. Yes. Yes. So, yeah, indeed.
That's why you have a finite number of.
Exactly. So, I think I write this later, but what will come out is that actually what you have, the classification of these different, all the possible. XGs, all the possible ways in which a certain group, so I'm giving a group and I'm asking what are all the possible ways in this group can be implemented using MPSs. Okay, so I only want to consider MPSs with that symmetry. Okay, I'm looking at MPSs that have that symmetry. How many different ways can somehow the symmetry be realized? And turns out that this is the group cohomology will have something like the group. Turns out that, of course, well, in generality, actually, you also have to kind of consider time reversal, also reflection. Actually, these are Z2 transformations versus U1. Okay, so this is basically the second group cohomology with, versus G times time reversal. This time reversal and reflection actually have a non-trivial action, and that's why you need this beta. There's some kind of non-trivial. It's a bit of an, I don't know what the mathematical term of is, but it's not the usual formula of a co-cycle. You have to actually also add this action to get the solution. But certainly if you don't have time reversal or reflection symmetries, then this beta is kind of irrelevant and you get normal two co-cycles. But this is all very well understood in mathematics, and it's actually very curious that these things pop up in these spin chains. And of course, these are topological arguments, and that's why somehow this has to do with topological order. Turns out that actually for higher dimensional cases, like if you go to two dimensions, so for the moment I restricted myself to one dimension, but if you go to higher dimensions, then what you will need is actually the three co-cycle. Like in two dimensions, you will need the three co-cycle, and in three dimensions, you really need the four co-cycle, and so further. So these are so all of these things generalize very nicely. Of course, in these three and four co-cycles, it's not just a simple projective representation. There's our kind of completely different objects that I hope I will be able to talk about later in the lecture.
So Frank, maybe that's a good point to remind you that we are sort of done with the official time.
Oi. So maybe this is very bad. I completely mistimed the thing. So should I, do you give me like 5 more minutes or something?
Okay, 4 minutes.
4 minutes. Okay, very good. Let me give you an example, AKLT.
I mean, you have another lecture on the Friday, so.
Sure, but still, I'm not even somehow in the middle of my first lecture. So the AIs are equal to the Pauli matrices. Okay, so what is the symmetry? It turns out that you can just these states are actually invariant under SO3 transformations. Okay, so you put any kind of matrix in SO3 on top of it. This is actually invariant. But if you kind of look at what happens on the virtual level, this AKLT state is actually transforming according to a projective representation of SO3. So they don't form a representation of SO3, they actually form a projective representation. And of course, this is very well understood by all physicists and mathematicians. This is like the simplest example of somehow such a projective representation that is super crucial in everything that has to do with physics, actually. Without if SU2 would not be a projective representation of SO3, we would not have fermions. The whole universe would not be stable, we would actually not exist. So we really have to thank I don't know whom, but for the existence of projective representations. Okay, let me skip this kind of thing. Let me kind of quickly go to the notion of a manifold of MPS, okay, because this is very much related to what we said before. Okay, so we have this manifold. So I said there's many to one kind of correspondence, so many tensors kind of correspond to the same state. And it turns out that you can actually kind of give this manifold the structure of a Kähler manifold. Okay? And the dimension of that space at the end is d minus 1 times chi squared. And why this minus 1? This is exactly because we have to subtract all these kind of matrices that are gauge invariant. We knew that actually these, so this the space here, of course, is d squared, d times chi squared. This is the number of complex variables in this space. But somehow the dimension of the manifold, if you kind of count the complex parameters, is actually d minus 1 times chi squared. And we used, of course, this gauge transforms to kind of bring these things into some nice mathematical or some kind of nice canonical form. And indeed, once you do this and you kind of work this out all a bit, this is. But you cannot find all of this in the lecture notes that I gave you somehow. So you can actually calculate the tangent space exactly. Okay, so you have some kind of a manifold of MPSs. And the really important thing, of course, if you have a manifold, is to kind of try to understand what are the tangent spaces. Okay, so we have this low-dimensional manifold, but nevertheless, we would like to understand the manifold structure. And by using these canonical forms, okay, that I taught you before, this where you have everything to the left is in the left canonical form, everything to the right is in the right canonical form, and then I had some kind of a center matrix, AC, that is in the middle. Turns out that you can very easily write down the projector on that tangent space in a certain point. Okay, so I have a certain point in this manifold. This is an MPS. Okay, I can somehow, depending, so it's a very nonlinear thing, of course, but given somehow this MPS M and the manifold M, I can write down the projector on the tangent space on that manifold. And it turns out that it has a very nice structure. It has like, it's a sum over all possible x's, like x's of the different sides. Of course, this runs from minus infinity to infinity, where everything to the left is basically this left form. This is an identity here, and then somehow a projector on this kind of objects to the right, minus somehow the sum over x, where somehow this middle kind of index has disappeared. Okay, this is can easily prove actually that this is the manifold. It's not easy. It's easy to, once I give you this formula, to check that this is the manifold. It's not so easy to guess that this is what it is. But let me kind of make the connection. I really wanted to say this because this makes the connection with what Thomas said. Actually, all the algorithms that people use, DMRG, IDMRG, Vroom's, whatever, all these kind of variants of this are at the end kind of in principle or nothing more than making use of that formula. So what this actually tells you, if you kind of have something like a Schrodinger equation, okay, so I have a Schrodinger equation that I want to solve. Well, of course, this is very hard. This is an exponentially large problem. Let me actually project. So the only thing you do is add here a projection. I add the projection on the tangent space that is, of course, depending on the state itself. And I'm evolving that Schrodinger equation instead. Of course, if I do this, I'm sure that I will stay in the manifold. So this is actually called the time-dependent variational principle. So I have some kind of a manifold structure. I force my state to stay in the manifold. And what you get then is a very nice nonlinear differential equation. Why nonlinear? Well, first of all, because this psi of A is, of course, a multilinear function of A, but also this projector actually depends on A. But you work out everything in a straightforward way, and you get an effective differential equation and somehow your space of tensors that basically governs or controls or tells you what somehow the evolution, the true Schrodinger evolution is projected on the manifold of matrix product states. And all somehow, what this actually, if you do this for with somehow this real time, this is for Schrödinger. If you put an I there, we call this real time. Turns out that this is actually, it has a symplectic structure. There's Poisson brackets, all these kind of things. So it preserves the energy. So all kind of very nice kind of properties that you can have. And this is called the TDVP. I'm not so sure that Thomas talked about this, but this is like this. So what you do now for kind of getting algorithms like DMRG, VRMS, and all these kind of things, the only thing you do is replace this I with the -1. Okay. So when you put a -1 there, you basically have something like imaginary time evolution. At the end, somehow this is just a different set of equations that tells you, well, I stay in this manifold, and DMRG and all these variants, whether it's DMRG or VRMS or whatever, they all related to each other by basically a different type, a different ways of integrating this equation. Okay, so this is a nonlinear differential equation for which somehow there's many competing terms. So there's many ways of splitting somehow this differential equation in different steps. All the different ways, all the different algorithms that people use, both for real time, imaginary time, or whatever time in DMRG, are basically just different ways of using splitting methods for solving this equation. And if you want somehow more details about this, you can actually check this this review paper on tangent space methods for uniform MPS if you want this. I think I really have to stop here.